What's up everyone, Kenji here, and in this video I thought I'd share the three main methods to value a company. So firstly, we'll look at the multiples-based approach, which is also known as the market-based approach. Secondly, we'll look at the discounted cash flow, also known as the DCF. And then thirdly, we'll look at the cost approach, which is probably the least common of the three. After that, we'll look at the pros and cons of each, because unfortunately none of them are actually perfect. And then lastly, we'll go over how to look at them all together with something that's known as the football field, which is a chart that looks like this one here. But before we get into it, why on earth would you want to value a company? Well, from a business point of view, you might want to value a company maybe because you're looking to acquire it, or vice versa, maybe you're looking to sell your own company or sell a department of your company and you want to know how much that's worth, right? So that's one reason you might want to value a company. The second more individual reason might be because, say, I'm looking to buy Apple shares and I want to know if I'm buying them at a good price, if they're a bit too expensive or they're undervalued and I could make some money on that, right? So that's another reason why you might want to value a company. And while I'm talking about valuing companies here, the same three valuation methods also apply to valuing other things, like what might be a piece of real estate, what might be, say, a piece of software, or even a department within a company, right? So they're really widespread. You can use them across all sorts of assets. So let's get into them. The first approach we'll be looking at is a multiples-based approach, which is also known as market-based. And if you don't know what a multiple is, it's basically a ratio, right? So it's one number over the other. A typical multiple, for instance, could be the PE ratio, price per share, divided by earnings per share. And in short, it's about comparing what your company is worth relative to other similar companies in the market, right? When you think about it, it's actually not that different to you, say, buying an apartment and seeing the price of the apartment relative to other apartments in the area, with the ratio or the multiple being the price per square foot or the price per square meter, right? And some of the more common multiples in finance, at least, could be enterprise value over sales. It could be price to earnings, like I mentioned earlier, enterprise value over EBITDA, which stands for earnings before interest, tax, depreciation, and amortization. I know it sounds a bit daunting, but in short, it's just another way to measure profitability. So let's look at an example, and let's say that we're trying to value company X using the PE multiple. And like I mentioned earlier, the P stands for the price per share, whilst the E stands for the earnings per share. And here, basically, you're gonna want to look for companies, firstly, that are similar to yours, right? Let's say company X is a tech company. So you look in the market for other companies in the same industry, in this case in tech. Let's say company X is primarily in Europe. So you wanna look for similar companies that are primarily in Europe as well. And also you wanna look at companies that are of similar sizes, right? You can't really compare a company that has 1 million in revenue to one that has 1 billion in revenue, right? And let's say that after doing some market research, we come up with five different companies, and not very creatively, I've named them A, B, C, D, and E. And so now we wanna find the relevant data to compare them, right? So in this case, we gotta find the price per share as well as the earnings per share for each of these companies. So once we have that information noted, we're now gonna be able to find the actual PE ratio for each of these five companies. And with that, we're then gonna take the average PE ratio for all the five. In this case, it's 7.9. And like I mentioned earlier, we wanna value company X, and let's say that we know that company X has an earnings of $3. So based on that, you're gonna be able to do the 3 times the 7.9, and that's gonna give you the share price. In this case, that's $23.55. And I do wanna point out that this example is very simplified. There's still a lot of flaws in it. So for instance, the PE ratio depends on earnings, right? The E down there means the earnings. But what if the company doesn't have any earnings? Maybe they didn't make a profit last year. Then how can you do a PE ratio? And the answer is that you can't. The PE ratio is not applicable in this case. So you would have to use some other ratios as well. That's why I mentioned earlier the enterprise value over sales, for instance. Also, in this case, we use the average, right? But sometimes the average isn't all that good, and that's mainly because it accounts for outliers, right? So if one of the, say, five companies we picked has a very, very high PE ratio, that means it's gonna bring the average absurdly high as well, right? Instead, you might want to use a median. Typically, for finance professionals, they use both the average and the median as well, just in case there's any outliers, where the median obviously doesn't account for them. And I could go on with many of the other simplifications that I had to make, but I don't want to make this video too long. But if you'd like me to do a video just specifically on the multiples-based approach, do let me know in the comments. If this one does well, make sure you hit that like and that subscribe. I will try to do a part 2 or something like that, where I'll just cover this specific valuation method. Now, the second approach is known as the DCF, the discounted cash flow, and this one's based on intrinsic valuation. And you're probably wondering, just like I did back in the day, well, what the hell does intrinsic mean? And basically, it just means that it focuses internally, so inherently within the company, as opposed to looking at external factors. When we looked at the multiples-based approach, it focused on other companies, right? Whilst when you look at the DCF intrinsically, that means that it's focusing internally on the company's operation, on its business, on its cash flows. And basically, a DCF is about finding the value of the company today based on future projections of how much money it's going to make in the future. And let's look at a simple example here. Let's say that based on past cash flow growth rates, we think that company X will be able to have stable cash flows of 10 million up until year 5. Okay, so we have these cash flows for the next 5 years. Does that mean that we just add up those 5 years and that's going to give us a valuation? And the answer is unfortunately no. And that's because of this thing called the time value of money, which you might be familiar with if you've taken some finance classes. And it basically says that a dollar today is worth more than a dollar in the future. And that's mainly because of things like inflation, right? Which is actually eroding the value of your money over time. So instead, we need to discount all these cash flows back to the present, right? Hence why it's called a discounted cash flow after all. And we'll do that using a discount rate. So the formula is gonna look something like this, and it looks a bit daunting, but to be honest, it's really not that hard. The CF up here is the cash flow, whilst on the bottom you have the R, which stands for the discount rate. And those numbers there you see, as well as the N, stand for the number of periods. In this case, for us, it's years, right? And let's say that the discount rate we wanna use is 5%. And so for year 1, that would be 10 million over 1 plus 5%. In year 2, that would be 11 million divided by 1 plus 5% squared, because it's year 2. And then year 3 would be cubed, and so on and so forth, right? And once you discount all of them back to the present and sum them all together, that's how you would get a valuation. In this case, it would be 23.29 million. Now, unfortunately, I need to break some bad news, and that's that it's quite simplified as a model, right? What about after those 5 years? Does the company just suddenly stop functioning? Probably not, right? There's probably gonna be some business beyond those 5 years. That's basically calculated using what's called the terminal value, which is essentially the value of the business after those 5 years. And this is a big assumption, right? You're saying that after this 5-year period, for the remaining life of the company, which you don't even know how long it's gonna live for, you're gonna value it at X amount. And there's really two main ways to calculate the terminal value. The first one is known as the perpetual growth method, and the second one is known as the exit multiple method. Now, I'm not gonna get into them in this video just because I don't want it to get too long, but I will leave a very good article, which is actually how I learned this back in the day, in the description as well. Also, another simplification that I wanted to point out here is the discount rate. In this case, we said it was 5%. I honestly made that number up. It could have been any other number, but in reality, there's actually a way to calculate this, and that's using the WACC, which stands for the Weighted Average Cost of Capital. Now, it's this massive formula. It looks a bit daunting, but to be honest, it's a lot simpler than it looks. And I'll leave an article on this formula in case you want to understand it and look further into it. I don't really want to get into it in this video, but like I said earlier, if you want me to do a full in-depth on DCF as well, do let me know in the comments. If this video does well, I will consider it, of course. So the third valuation approach I'm gonna be covering is known as the cost approach. It's also sometimes called the replacement cost approach. Basically, this one's very common in real estate, not so much in corporate finance roles like what might be, say, investment banking or private equity. In short, it says that the value of the business should be the cost to replace it with an equivalent new one, right? So for example, if your business just burned down, say your factory burned down one day, what would be the cost to create a new one just like that, right? That's basically how they would measure it. And overall, what it's saying is that if it would cost you, say, 10 million to replace that, then you don't want to pay anything more than 10 million for that, right? So let's look at the formula for this, and let's say that we're valuing a house. So the formula would be the replacement cost, which is basically the cost of the construction, the architect, and so on, minus depreciation, which is basically the wear down of the house over time, right? Which is actually making it less valuable. And then lastly, you want to add the value of the land that it sits on. Now, this approach works best for tangible things, which are basically things that you can touch, right? Think, say, a manufacturing plant, a house, or a cell tower, for instance. That's primarily because you know the cost of each thing quite well. While on the other hand, for something like, say, an intangible or something that you can't touch, like what might be a software, a specific algorithm, you can't really replicate the cost in the same way, because maybe you just had one genius founder that managed to make this algorithm that no one else can. In that case, it's not like you can pay somebody else to try do it, right? So the costs there are a bit blurred, hence why it's a lot more common in real estate, for instance. Now let's look at the pros and cons of each method, and starting off with the multiples approach here, among the big pros is that it's quite intuitive, right? It's easy to understand, it's quite relatively easy to do, and so that's one of the main pros about it. Now on the con side, it's really not that easy to find similar companies to the one you're trying to value, right? Let's say I'm trying to value Amazon, for instance. There's really not that many companies that are all that similar, of the same size, same geography, same e-commerce market, and so on and so forth, right? Like, let's say we wanna compare it to Walmart, for instance, another big retailer, but Walmart's not so focused on the e-commerce space, it's more on physical stores, and so it's not that easy to actually find good comparing companies. Now moving on to the DCF, and the main pro here is that it's independent of the market, right? Like I mentioned earlier, it's about the intrinsic value. So whatever the competitors are doing doesn't really matter. And that's particularly good, say, for instance, if you're in a recession, most of your competitors are gonna be really down, right? So if you use a multiples-based valuation, odds are your company is gonna be very down as well, right? While, for instance, if you use a DCF, that's gonna be independent of how the market's doing, and instead you'll really have a core view of whatever your business is looking like. One of the big cons in the DCF is that it's hard to do, right? It's very time consuming. So if you've ever been asked in an interview to do a valuation on a company and you have the choice of doing a multiples approach versus a DCF, you always want to pick the multiples approach just because it's going to make your life a lot easier, right? Another big con here are the assumptions, and it's heavily assumption based, right? And so that means that you might be a bit too optimistic on your company, you might be a bit too pessimistic on it, and based on that you're gonna have a flawed valuation, right? Typically, I will say though that for a DCF, say in a professional setting, there's usually gonna have a lot of different case scenarios. So for instance, you'll have a base case, which is what you normally expect the company to do. You'll also have a best case, so a very optimistic scenario, say you think like it's gonna grow a lot more, you're gonna expand into new countries and so on and so forth. And then you'll have a worst case scenario, like say, I don't know, you get sued a couple times and so on and so forth. So based on those three, you'll actually derive three different valuations, and based on how you're feeling, you're gonna go with one or the other. Lastly, looking at the cost approach, and the main pro here is that it's very easy to do, right? It's quite easy to understand. But on the con side, the costs are actually not that easy to account for, right? Maybe it cost you, say, $100,000 to construct the house 5 years ago, but now the market's been booming, and so it's a lot more expensive to construct the house now. Things like that, that maybe they're not that clear as you might expect, right? Another con of the cost approach has to do with government permits, right? And specifically with regulation. So for instance, maybe you had a warehouse and that's been there for 20 years, but now the new regulation says that you can't actually build anything in that area. So now you can't really have a replacement cost anymore, right? Because you can't build anything. So that's where the model kind of might get flawed. And as you've seen in this pros and cons analysis, none of the three methods are actually perfect, right? They all have some flaws somewhere. And that's why valuation is mainly regarded as both an art and a science. And this brings us nicely to the last point, which is the football field valuation. And like I mentioned earlier, because none of the three methods are actually perfect, what they do is they actually bundle them together in a graph looking like this, so that you can kind of get a range based on that. So it's called a football field because that's what it resembles, right? I do think it requires a bit of imagination, but well, I think the name's there to stay. Also, you can see that there's actually a 52-week high and low range as well, and that's quite common to have in there, which is basically the share price, how it fluctuated throughout the 52 weeks, so the last year, right? So looking at Apple, for instance, here you can find its 52-week high and low range too. Overall though, when it comes to valuation, the analyst isn't actually looking for a specific number. Instead, they're looking to derive a valuation range, right? And let me know in the comments if you'd like me to do a three-part series where I cover each of the three valuation methods. Maybe I could make it Excel-based where I actually do a full case study of, say, Apple or a big company like that, and we try to value it together. So that's all for this video. I hope you found it useful, and I'll catch you in the next one.